Good morning, and welcome to St. Anne. My name's Brad Hubbard. I'm the coordinator of outreach here at the parish, and we have a few announcements for you here this morning. So we are in need of 20 new altar servers for the 10 a.m. Mass. If you are interested in helping serve during the liturgy, our altar servers ministry has hands-on training to help you get prepared. You can also receive volunteer hours for this. The next meeting is on July 5th. Registration is required, and you can find more information in the bulletin. If the Lord may be tugging on your heart to learn more and experience Him through Scripture, we encourage you to explore our fall Bible studies, and you can find out more about all of those at stannanparish.org/Bible-studies. Just want to let you know the second collection for this weekend is for the Holy Father, which allows the Vatican to respond with emergency financial assistance to requests to aid the neediest worldwide. So that's all for our announcements, but as we've been doing for the past couple weeks, we'd like to pray together the Transcend campaign prayer, which is on the back of your song sheets, if you could pull those out. We ask for more of the Holy Spirit to wrap this entire campaign in prayer as we pray this together. Heavenly Father, you marvelously formed our human nature, and in the fullness of time sent your only Son to even more wondrously elevate it. Grant us, we pray, that made partakers in your divine nature through the Eucharist, we may be continuously transformed by the renewal of our minds. Send forth your Holy Spirit to guide us as we work to renew our church in beauty and grandeur. Through this campaign to transcend the ordinary, draw us closer to you and one another in bonds of faith, hope, and charity. Let this work be yours, not our own. For if you do not build the house, in vain do the builders labor. Through Christ our Lord. St. Joseph, model of artisans, pray for us. All right, if you can please stand and introduce yourself to your neighbors around you.
And let us join our voices in singing the opening hymn, Praise to the Lord.
Surely his goodness and mercy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Brothers and sisters, in our gospel today, the Lord will call us to take up our own personal cross, to follow after him. As we begin this Mass, as we celebrate this week the freedoms that we enjoy in our country, let us acknowledge those times where we in our freedom have chosen not to follow after the Lord, where we have set down the cross because it has become too heavy, and ask him to strengthen us by the power of his grace. Let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to receive these sacred mysteries.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Let us be seated and strengthened by the word of God.
A reading from the second book of Kings. One day, Elisha came to Shunem, where there was a woman of influence who urged him to dine with her. Afterward, whenever he passed by, he used to stop there to dine. So she said to her husband, "I know that Elisha is a holy man of God. Since he visits us often, let us arrange a little room on the roof and furnish it for him with a bed, table, chair, and lamp, so that when he comes to us, he can stay there." Sometime later, Elisha arrived and stayed in the room overnight. Later, Elisha asked, "Can something be done for her?" His servant, Gehazi, answered, "She has no son, and her husband is getting on in years." Elisha said, "Call her." When the woman had been called and stood at the door, Elisha promised, "This time, next year, you will be fondling a baby son." The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, we too might live in newness of life. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no longer any power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once for all. As to his life, he lives for God. consequently, you too must think of yourselves as dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
With you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his apostles, "Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me. And whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. Whoever receives a prophet, because he is a prophet, will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever receives a righteous man, because he is a righteous man, will receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever gives only a cup of cold water to one of these little ones to drink, because the little one is a disciple, amen, I say to you, he will surely not lose his reward." The Gospel of the Lord.
As someone who hears a lot of confessions, we spend a lot of time in our confessional box forgiving sins. The most dangerous thing that I hear when I listen to people's confessions is this. They will say, "I knew this was a sin, and I chose it anyway, because I knew that I could go to confession. I knew that Jesus would forgive me." That presumption of God's mercy misses the point of God's mercy. Now, if you've thought that before, don't worry. This has been a common problem since the beginning of the church. Ever since St. Paul wrote the book of Romans, this has been a thought upon Christians' hearts. You can see in Romans, we read from Romans chapter 6 today, he says that we ought to think of ourselves as Christ did, as dead to sin and living in his new life. The reason why this statement comes up is because Paul has been moving us through the book of Romans. Romans 1 and 2 is kind of an introduction. It starts off very boldly. Paul says in Romans 1:16, I am unashamed of the gospel because it has the power to save. I am unashamed of the gospel. And then it very quickly moves to chapter 3, where there is a question raised. What saves us? Is it the works of the law, or is it faith in Jesus Christ? Because the Jewish people, they said you still had to keep the law even if you became Christian, and there were 613 laws that they meticulously followed. And so Paul raises this question and then answers it. He says, we are no longer bound by the law. We are saved by faith in Jesus Christ. And he answers this in Romans 3, Romans 4, and Romans 5. But then in Romans 6, where we pick up today, there's another question raised. It says, well, if we're saved by faith, and we don't have to worry about the works of the law, can we do whatever we want, even sin? Because we have faith in Jesus? And Paul says, no. No, you cannot sin. This is not permission to sin. Jesus did not atone for your sin so that you could disown him. Sin, in its very basic definition, is rejecting God's love. In the gospel, he gives an invitation to take up our cross, to deny the temptations of this world and to choose him. And sin says, no, I'm okay with the world. Faith in Jesus is not congruent with sin. And that is what St. Paul argues. He does in Romans chapter 6, he lays out three analogies. The first analogy is death, the second analogy is slavery, and the third analogy is marriage. He says that we are supposed to live our lives like we are dead to sin. We have died. Adam's sinfulness, original sin, has been dead and killed within us. And now we are meant to raise, like Jesus Christ, from that death to new life, where sin has no power, no mastery over us. As we continue through Romans chapter 6, you will read carefully that he talks about slavery, servitude, how in our past life we were slaves to sin. But now we serve the Lord. And Romans chapter 6, 21 through 23 says, serving the Lord, if we have to have a choice between serving the Lord and serving sin, serve the Lord. It's a much better deal. It says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. What we earn through our sin is eternal death and sadness. And what we receive freely from the Lord in faith is life. And then it says, we were married to sin beforehand, but with the death of Christ, he frees us. When we enter into the baptism of death, that marriage only lasts through death. And so now we are dead to our spouse of sin, and we are chosen by our bridegroom, Jesus Christ, to live in relationship forever with him. It is a beautiful scripture to walk through. But perhaps you have not let the Lord put to death all the sin in your heart. Perhaps we are still enslaved to a particular vice. And perhaps our marriage covenant with the Lord is not yet perfect. He's perfect, but we are not. There's an opportunity here. We don't say, well, I know that Jesus Christ will forgive me, so it's okay that we can sin. Our faith in Jesus Christ should push us forward, should draw us into this invitation so that we fight against sin, so that we do not give up hope. So many people live their lives thinking, this is sin has been with me for such a long time, it's just going to be there forever. No. Jesus Christ did not just die on the cross to free you from the consequences of sin, which is death. He came and died on the cross to free you from sin. To free you from sin. And so no matter what your sin is, maybe you have a problem with your speech, lying and gossiping. Maybe you have a problem with the amount of alcohol that you drink or what you look at on the computer, or that you are living in fear within your marriage and allowing contraception to be part of that. Or maybe you live in the spirit of greed that makes you hoard all that you possess, not sharing it with the mission of the church or with the poor. Perhaps there is just a selfishness that lives within us that does not allow us to see or care about the other. This is exactly where the Lord wants to heal, and we cannot make the excuse, it's okay, Jesus loves me. And so I want to talk today, if you can diagnose a particular sin within your heart, how can we allow the Lord to continue to not just free us from the consequences, but to actually free us from this sin? So tonight or tomorrow in your daily prayer, I want you to do four things. All you have to do is take out a piece of paper and a pencil. Grab a piece of paper and a pencil in your prayer time, and in order to wage war against this sin, to put it to death, to end the slavery to it, and to choose the marriage covenant of Christ and Christ alone, this is what I want us to do. On that piece of paper in your prayer time, you start off. And the first thing that you do is you write all the justifications, all of the rationalizations, all of the reasons and excuses that you make for your sin. I don't drink that much. They're just small little white lies. How would I talk with my coworkers if I didn't make fun of other coworkers? We wouldn't be able to take family vacations if we had more children. The movies that I watch aren't that bad. Write the justifications and the rationalizations down. Those things that we say to ourselves that permit our sin. The next thing I want you to do is to talk about the near occasions and write down with yourself in the dialogue with the Spirit, diagnose the near occasion of sin and the precursors to the sin. Is there a particular person that it is most difficult to be holy around? Is it a particular place that is leading you towards sin? And I say precursors as well because sometimes it's not a person or a place. Sometimes it's just a season of our life. Man, I know that summers I have a little bit more free time, and that idleness is difficult for me. Or maybe it's more of an emotion. Maybe when we feel stressed or we're alone or we're anxious or fearful, that's when the sin speaks most clearly to our heart. And so we write down those near occasions and those precursors. The third thing I want you to do is to pray to the Holy Spirit and write down someone's name that is closer to the Lord in the way of discipleship than you are. Write down a friend that you can think of that has had some victory over sin and is carrying their cross and walking a little bit further ahead than you. And pray about sharing the struggle with them so that they can pray for you, so that they can talk to you about tools and tips and tricks to be able to overcome this sin. Because when we bring something to the light in the community of believers, there is power. Jesus says, wherever there are two or three gathered in my name, there I am in their midst. Now, if you don't have any friends that are further along in the faith than you are, we need to make sure that we're building community here within the church so that we can have those mature disciples within our lives. And the fourth and final thing that I need you to do is write down the next time that you can go to the Sacrament of Reconciliation. And when you go to Reconciliation, I want you to bring these lists, these four things. And we confess the rationalizations, we confess the excuses, we confess the justifications for our sins. And then we confess the times that we knew that we were feeling lonely and we didn't go to prayer. Or we knew that this person wasn't a good influence and we still chose to place ourselves in their sphere of influence. And we make that confession. And then we pray in the midst of that for God's mercy, that we may put to death sin, that we may no longer serve and earn the wages, that is death, and that we may choose the bridegroom who first chose us, Jesus Christ, who dies on the cross. And if we do this, my brothers and sisters, sin will have no mastery over us. There will be a peace, not just in knowing that we are forgiven, but a peace where we know that we are free to live a life in Christ. And that life in Christ does not begin at the moment we die with Him in heaven. It begins today. And we take up our cross and follow Him. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us, our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
And I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life.
God our Father, rejoicing that you have sent your Son into the world and in the invitation to follow after Him from this life to the life to come, we know that we need your help against sin, and so we turn to you with our prayers.
For the church, may God strengthen her holy mission to bear abundant fruit in the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That peace may be proclaimed in our country, both within and without. As we celebrate the anniversary of our independence this coming week, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who struggle in carrying their cross, may the Spirit of consolation give them strength. We pray to the Lord. For that all those now discerning their vocations will not be afraid to lose their lives in order to gain them for Christ as priests, deacons, and in the consecrated life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us gathered here and are called to be hospitable to those around us, may the Lord help us to be better stewards of our blessings. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and all those who care for them, may God's grace bring them healing and strength, especially those whose names are in the prayer chain. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our nation, that God will guide us in living the values which we proclaim, so that all may experience life, liberty, and justice, we pray to the Lord.
I'd like to pray for our great country that we live in, the freedoms that we enjoy and that we recognize are not granted us by a man or a government, but are endowed to us by our Creator. May we use these freedoms to the praise and glory of His name. Let us pray a Hail Mary, that we may always use this freedom to give glory to God. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And we pray for all of our leaders within our country, our president, our congressmen and women, all appointed judges, that they may use the power entrusted to them by the people to bring about truth, beauty, and goodness. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our Father, we offer you all of these prayers that you may hear and answer them according to your plan for us through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Please be seated as we prepare our altar.
We take up our cross and follow. might live. We carry the hope of Christ within. We take up our cross and follow Him. We take up our cross and follow.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and the good of all His holy church.
O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, He humbled Himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, He freed us from an ending death. And by rising from the dead, He gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Anne, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope and Edward our Bishop, Gregory's assisting bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of Christ's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
As we prepare our hearts for Holy Communion, it is important to remember that we as Catholics believe something truly unique about the Eucharist, that it is the real presence of Jesus Christ. Therefore, only Catholics are able to receive the Eucharist during this time of Holy Communion. If you are joining with us from a different Protestant denomination, or you are just beginning your walk with our Lord, or perhaps you are a Catholic that does not regularly practice their faith or is not prepared to receive Holy Communion this week, we would invite you to come forward for a blessing rather than receiving the Eucharist. You can indicate that you would like to receive a blessing by placing your hands over your heart as a sign of prayer, bowing and pausing for a moment as you reach the front of our ordinary communion line. Thank you.
A grain of wheat shall fall upon
And the ground, Thank you.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord. We pray so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever. Through Christ our Lord. Brothers and sisters, with great joy, on July 1st, we welcomed two new priests here at St. Anne's, Father Aristero Barum and Father Kevin Wilwert. They started yesterday. Today is their first day of Sunday Masses. Continue to pray for them and for Father Samuel and Father Ramiro, who served with us. But our new priests, we are very excited about them. They're going to be here at the end of Mass out in the narthex for you to be able to meet. Also, we have one of our own that was ordained a Jesuit priest this month. And so Father Eddie Goh is going to be celebrating the 4:30 p.m. Mass as a Mass of Thanksgiving. Just pray for him and his future ministry. He didn't become diocesan. I don't hold that against him. the Jesuits are fine, and we're very happy to have him as a priest serving our Lord. Have a great 4th of July celebrating the freedoms that we enjoy. If you need a birthday blessing, a travel blessing, an anniversary blessing, or if it's been just a rough week, Deacon and I will be in the narthex after Mass to pray with you and for you. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you so much.